الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على نبينا الكريم والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين نسأل الله تعالى أن يحفظنا ويهدينا ويرشدنا. We begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we remind ourselves to always offer peace and blessings upon the last and final messenger, his family and his companions and all those who follow them until the day of judgment. And we remind ourselves that the end result, the victory, is always for the person with taqwa, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will always stand with that individual, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the wali of the muttaqeen and of the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the guardian and the protector of the believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defends the believers. And our religion is a religion that is outspoken, that deals with our realities and very much is capable of dealing with any challenge or situation or threat that may be presented to us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us and make us among those who are guided on the straight path, the people of as-sirat al-mustaqim, sirat al-ladhina an'ama Allahu alayhim min an-nabiyyin was-siddiqin wash-shuhada'i was-salihin wa hasuna ulaika rafiqa, dhalika al-fadlu min Allah wa kafa billahi wakila. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among the people who follow the path of the prophets and the righteous and the martyrs and those who follow faith. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with that. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَّفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً ۚ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامَ ۚ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا ۚ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا يُصْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. أَمَّا بَعْدُ. I encourage us that as we listen to the contents of this khutbah, to really take it as an encouragement to think and to reflect upon the contents more so than to draw conclusions. My goal is to spark a conversation within ourselves and even more within the community about a very, very important issue that we are all witnessing today and perhaps has been plaguing mankind, or at least the Muslim and our Western world, for about 60, 70 years now. And that is the issue of identity. Why is identity such a major issue now? And in order to really engage this, we need to ask the question, well, what is identity? Who is the one who has authority to define identity? And in order to do that, we really need to look at how certain cultures or civilizations or people or religions define identity, specifically human identity. And to do that, I start off by quoting Bill O'Reilly. If you remember, in 2008, when Obama won the election, Fox News went crazy, right? And here are some quotes from Bill O'Reilly that really are puzzling. He says, the white establishment is now the minority. And then he says, and the voters, many of them feel that the economic system is stacked against them and they want stuff. He also says, the demographics are changing. And he says, it's not a traditional America anymore. Now, when you hear this, it's quite puzzling. How is the election of Obama an election process that is a symbol foundational to America, the democratic process? How is the result of a democratic process threatening traditional America? This is the question. Right? And in fact, if I remember correctly, one of them in this Fox News said, our country is being taken away from us. What does all this mean? And in order to really dive into the perspective of these individuals, I quote Michael Wintle in his book, Cultural Identity in Europe. This is very important. Listen to what he says. The key influences on European experience are the Roman Empire, Christianity, the Enlightenment, and industrialization. It is because these historical movements have not influenced Muslim immigrant experience that they are not those whose home is Europe. These movements are precisely what others have designated European civilization, a notion that takes Europe to be a subject of civilization and not of merely natural territory. In other words, if we were to ask the question, are our brothers and sisters from Bosnia European? Are they by definition European? And the answer is no. Russia, part of which is part of Europe, and of some Eastern European countries, are not considered European. Turkey has been trying to become a member of the EU, but has been rejected. The question is why? Why are our brothers and sisters from Bosnia, who are mainly blonde-haired, blue-eyed, white-skinned, who are part of the European continent, not considered European? Because they don't come from the same history which Europe defines to be European. That is the Roman, Christian, Enlightenment, industrialization history. And if you look at European history as a whole, Muslim Spain is omitted from that. Why? Because it's not part of Europe. And that's why Muslims who are living as minorities in Europe are having a lot of problems by both the conservative and the liberal ideologies. Why? Because you're not European. So immigrants who went from Syria to, or from the Muslim world to Europe in recent times, they're having a lot of problems and causing a lot of political chaos. Why? Because they're technically not European. Why? Based on definition. And remember, the idea here is not to draw conclusions to say that Europe is are evil people or they're unjust. That's not the goal here. Just to kind of think and understand this. So when you look back, going back to O'Reilly's statement, we have to ask the question, according to him or according to Fox News, who is American? And it would seem like someone like Obama technically isn't really an American. Why? Well, of course, maybe because of his skin color. So simply having the American citizenship, according to some people within America, and America is different than Europe. Let's put that out there, right? But according to some sectors of the American society, simply having an American citizenship, sharing the experience in terms of the lifestyle of America, does not make you technically an American. There is more that you need. But the problem here is a fundamental one, that the definition, or this definition of human identity, goes back to features that are out of the control of the human being. So you're either born into this or you're not. And if you're not, tough luck. You can't do anything about that. So someone who is born of a different culture, from a different country, or has a different physical complexion, are at a disadvantage. And what you see now is that this has become a very, very big battle within our own country. And the two sides of the ideological spectrum, the conservative and the liberals. The liberals, understanding this reality, what they are trying to do now is kind of incorporate these minorities to or within American history. So now there's a lot of, there are classes, for example, in college that talk about minority voices in American history, for example, or literature of the minorities in American history. Why? To try and incorporate these minorities, that they are part of the American experience, so that they don't have to deal with these challenges anymore. That is the perspective they are coming from. Others are coming from a different perspective, saying, no, we need to keep them out because that's threatening our identity. And it is very important from here to start looking at the Islamic understanding of identity. And of course, as being Muslims, knowing our history, we know how beautiful it is. However, I'd like to point to some things that maybe we have not noticed before, starting with the Quran. And that is, whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as far as I have my own research, anytime Allah in the Quran talks about the human being, He adds two elements almost consistently, if not every single time. Whenever Allah talks about human beings, whether it's the creation or general humanity, He brings two elements into play. And that is, number one, that He is our creator. And number two, that we will return to Him consistently. So take for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. Indeed, we are the ones who gave nobility to the children of Adam. Going back, our origins are from where? From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَحَمَلْنَاهُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ رَزَقْنَاهُ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَفَضَّلْنَاهُمْ عَلَى كَثِيرٍ مِمَّنْ خَلَقْنَا تَفْضِيلًا. What comes after? يَوْمَ نَدْعُو كُلَّ أُنَاسٍ بِإِمَامِهِمْ. And on the day where we call each person by their book or by the person they followed, our origins from Allah and where we're going to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Fatir, يَا أَيُّهَا الْإِنسَانُ مَا غَرَّكَ بِرَبِّكَ الْكَرِيمِ الَّذِي خَلَقَكَ فَسَوَّاكَ فَعَدَلَكَ فِي أَيِّ سُورَةٍ مَا شَاءَ رَكَّبَكَ كَلَّا بَلْ تُكَذِّبُونَ بِالدِّينِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O mankind, what has deceived you? What has taken you away from your Lord, the generous, the one who created you and gave you your image and provides you? And then after that, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Rather, they disbelieve in their return to Allah. Whenever Allah talks about the human being, He brings these two elements into play, and that is He is the Creator and our return is to Him. And notice the very first verses of the Quran are what? اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. We don't have time to go into the details here. But essentially Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the very first verses revealed to mankind, He's talking about our origins. Recite, proclaim, but in the name of your Lord, the one who created you. What is the very last verse revealed in the Quran? وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And be conscious, have taqwa of the day in which you will return to Allah. That is the Quran. Our origins are with Allah, or from Allah, and our end is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the rest of the Quran is telling us how to be within those two realities. And that is a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what makes this so profound, so effective, is that the Quran gives human identity a theological, ideological definition, not a socio-political one. And therefore, every human being, according to us, was created by Allah. And every human being is going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So although not every human being is Muslim, every human being shares with Muslims their origins and their end. And therefore, there are many similarities in that regard. And therefore, when we look at a fellow human being, we look at them from a theological lens, reminding us that this individual is a creation of Allah. And therefore they get their sanctity from who? From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that Allah is their Lord, not us. And it is upon us to be servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you see this very clearly reflective in the era of the companions and even beyond that. So we have the very famous quote of Umar radiallahu anhu, who after hearing that Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu was actually abusing someone who was captured. Umar radiallahu anhu said, what did he say about that? How, under what right have you made this person a slave when their mother gave birth to them as a free person? And Ali radiallahu anhu says, in regards to the Muslims, the Muslim men who are married to Christians or Jews, he says, although they are not Muslim like us, they are humans like us, so be kind to them. And that is the idea here. And therefore, in Islamic history, you find that they did a very good job in incorporating minorities to the social realities of the Muslims. That being part of another religion or part of a different ethnicity does not make you fundamentally different than a Muslim. The only difference is in terms of religion and our ritual practices, but when it comes to our humanity, which is theological to us, every human being is equal in that regard. And we all know the famous saying of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in the farewell sermon, in which she says, an Arab is not better than a non-Arab, and a non-Arab is not better than an Arab. A black person is not better than a white person, and a white person is not better than a black person. The best amongst you are those who are most pious. So yes, there is a system in which we say someone is better than another. But what is that system? What is that tool that we use? Is taqwa. And why is it so beautiful and important and effective? Is because anyone can be a person of taqwa. Because everyone has equal access to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Regardless of race, regardless of society, regardless of culture, regardless of where they are born or when they are born. Everyone has the ability to reach out to Allah and to be a person of taqwa. And therefore, when it comes to the hierarchy of society, Islam presents one where anyone and everyone has equal access to being a noble person. And it's in their hands, regardless of their situation. This is very powerful. And this is a solution that is very much needed here in America. The problem of race. And by the way, this doesn't mean no Muslim was racist. And in modern times, there's a lot of racism in the Muslim world. But I ask you the following question. When did this racism come? Has it always been there? Or is it a result of what's called nation states? Meaning, was racism widespread prior to the splitting of the Muslim nation into states or countries, or after? Because when nation states were presented to the Muslim world, where the Muslim world became Pakistan and Jordan and Palestine and Saudi Arabia, etc., with that came nationalism. And with nationalism came a human identity that's socio-political, and with that came racism. So it is important that we reflect on this, and that we look to one another from a theological lens and not a socio-political one. Because we are all to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلُوا قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. Some of the benefits of living life in this manner, identifying human beings in this manner, are a few. First and foremost, everyone has access to this identity. Meaning, just because someone is part of a different culture does not make them lesser of a Muslim. And Khalid ibn Walid said this very clearly to George, the general of the Roman army. He said, George asked Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu, if I become a Muslim, what would be my status? He said, you would be like us, for you is what we have and upon you is what's upon us. You are equal to us. In fact, you will be better than us. Because we, meaning the companions, believed in the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam after seeing him and seeing his miracles. Whereas you believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam without seeing him. And that is a sign of faith and iman. And that is a virtue for you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala points this out. He says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْ بَعْدُ وَهَاجَرُوا وَجَاهَدُوا مَعَكُمْ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مِنْكُمْ. Those who believe after you and do the acts of believers such as hijrah and fighting and striving for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you find they are amongst you. Just because they don't have the same history as you does not exclude them from your circle or your identity. You are one in the same. Because religiously, we are not confining people to their history or their past, or require them to be of some sort of cultural or ethnic background. Another benefit of this is that this definition of human identity is protected by the fact that it is unchangeable. How so? Our identity goes back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We define ourselves based on the way Allah defined us and who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as our Lord. Can anyone change Allah? If no one can change Allah, that means they can't change our identity. And therefore, our identity cannot be used as a tool for manipulation or for business or for whatever, or political strife or political gains. We cannot be used as a tool for people, as pawns, throwing them left and right in order for some sort of worldly gain. It is unchangeable. So that we always have the ability to be someone who is dignified as a human being and as a Muslim. Another benefit of this is that no one can take it away from you. Meaning, when our definition of a human being is that it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, can anyone interfere in that or with that? Can anyone take that away from you? Can anyone overpower Allah? وَالْحَاشَ بِاللَّهِ. Can anyone overpower Allah or exclude Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entirely to where our identity is now threatened? That cannot happen. So when we, and this is a need, this is a must for us as Muslims, when we begin to look at ourselves from within and at greater society, outwardly, that we belong to Allah, created by Allah, and going back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it really changes a lot of things. And there's a lot of things you can branch out from this. And inshallah, this is a solution to racism, regardless of where it is. And this is a solution to human dignity and also a protection from the fluctuation of human identity. To where now, this is cool, this is human, what it means to be human. 10 years later, next generation says, no, it's something else. And people find themselves going left and right and they have no idea, they're confused, who am I? We don't need to do that, we don't need to get into that. So remember, my dear brothers and sisters, the Quran defines what it means to be a human being. And that we are created by Allah, and that we are going back to Allah. Everyone is like this, regardless of race or religion. But we as Muslims have the extra element that we are servants of Allah. We implement this and we live by it. This is a solution to many problems, many socio-political problems, which I hope as a community, as individuals, we can have that conversation within ourselves and really start to transform the way we look at ourselves and the way we look at others. قُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us and to make us among the dignified and the noble. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among the muttaqeen, those who embody taqwa and those who live by it. Allahumma ighfir lil muslimin wal muslimat wal mu'minin wal mu'minat al ahya'i minhum wal amwat innaka samii'un qareebun mujibud da'awati ya rabbil alamin. Allahumma aslih lana deenana alladhi huwa 'ismatu amrina wa aslih lana dunyana allati fiha ma'ashuna wa aslih lana akhiratana allati ilayha ma'aduna waj'al al hayata ziyadatan lana fi kulli khair waj'al al mauta rahatan lana min kulli shar.